This is what happens when half the board doesn't make it to a meeting. We all wear many hats. So tonight I have the privilege of introducing Gail and Max Vidrine, who are gracious enough to come tonight from Louisiana. Gail is a graduate of William Woods University in Fulton, Missouri. As her profession, she taught special education in Louisiana elementary schools for nearly 20 years. She is currently completing her training as a master naturalist, and her interests in nature are varied. One passion is Cajun prairies, and she has worked on numerous Cajun prairie projects. A second interest is herbal remedies for common conditions, and I kind of think that sounds like a second program. And now to Max. He holds a bachelor's and a master's in zoology from LSU and a PhD in biology from the University of Louisiana, Lafayette. He is a retired LSU Eunice biology professor. He has worked on projects as varied as armadillos and Hansen's disease, mosquito abatement, and the relationship of freshwater mussels, snails, and mites. Legend Max's time now revolves around prairies. He served on the Coastal Prairie Partnership, and in 2010, he authored The Cajun Prairie, A Natural History. Besides giving an amazing history and in-depth overview of Louisiana Coastal Prairie, the book contains 26 appendices that cover everything from blooming times of plants to coefficients of conservation value for prairie plants to lists of animals found in prairies. It is a valuable resource. Max's research includes prairie ecology and restoration, natural landscaping, and butterfly gardening. The butterfly gardening led to growing milkweeds, and that is what brought us all here tonight. Please join me in welcoming Gail and Max Vidrine.
Thank you for inviting me. My wife Gail will be managing the computer while I'm trying to do some talking. The one thing I worry about is losing my voice. This Houston air is very thick. So we're going to do a talk on growing Cajun prairie milkweeds, and I'm going to ask you to hold your questions to the end. I assume you'll have a lot of questions. And I'll try to run through the program and inform you so that you don't have that many questions. All right, so let's begin. Gail and I own and manage Cajun Prairie Gardens. It's a 1.5 acre restoration in our front yard. If you look at the sign, you can see that we're interested in monarchs, right? So. And of course, the bright orange thing that looks like it's on fire is a milkweed. This is the one that people really go crazy about. This is a butterfly weed. Next slide. Thanks. And of course, we're going to try to articulate a discussion of milkweeds and monarchs. They go together, not only biologically, but in every conversation regarding either. So, and I'll name the things later. So let's, next slide. This is a family project. Everything we do is a family project. This is my wife and daughter, Gail and Caroline. Right now, if you go to the Cajun Prairie Gardens, what's blooming is Louisiana irises. We grow over 100 different kinds of Louisiana irises. And of course, this is the giant blue one that's in the marshes. Next. And my two sons helping me put up the sign. Daniel's in the middle and Mackie is on the left. Next. They've been in the garden since they were children. So this is Daniel. I guess he's 4 or 5 years old. About the same height as that pock-pock plant over on the right. That's what we call Baptisia, because you can use the leaves to dye Easter eggs. And in Cajun land, we pock Easter eggs, knock them together until one breaks. And like everything else, we bet on everything we do. So there's a bet riding on which one breaks first, right? Next slide. is our daughter Caroline. You can see the prairie is not always full of flowers. Sometimes it's just a bunch of grasses, and they're as tall as she is. Next slide. So here's my basic outline for this presentation. A bit of history. The prairie garden throughout the year. And we'll talk about milkweeds, growing milkweeds, monarchs, and we'll key in on what the real problem is, and that's biodiversity. Next slide. A bit of history. The Great Southwestern Prairie, which we call the Cajun Prairie, covered 2.5 million acres in 1700. That same prairie extends here all the way down to Corpus Christi. It's known as the Coastal Prairie. There are some distinguishing differences, but not as many as you might think. The French, of course, are the ones who developed southwestern Louisiana, so a lot of French names. But there are also a lot of German names. The Germans came in and began to convert the land into an agricultural base, other than growing cattle. Next slide. So here's a general illustration of what we call the Cajun Prairie. 2.5 million acres, right smack dab in the middle of southwestern Louisiana. Our home is right here, right next to R and Great. So you have an idea where it's at. Next slide. And the thing about prairie that most people do not appreciate is that it's a farm-maintained system. You can mow it for a while and get by, but you begin to lose species. So if you want to maintain the highest diversity, you want to have FAR as part of your management plan. There's a lot of ways you can do FAR and manage it within what you're doing, but FAR is essential, even in a prairie garden. Next slide. Remnant prairies. The whole idea of prairie is not mine. I literally steal everything as far as ideas from somebody else. I'm a problem solver, so once I identify a problem, I try to solve it by looking at every piece of work done by anybody I can find and then try to redo it in my place and in my time. So as far as prairies, they were rediscovered along railroad tracks and in graveyards throughout the Midwest. And so in the 1980s, Dr. Allen and I searched for those prairies in Louisiana along railroad tracks, and we found them. Small remnants, usually not very wide, maybe 50 meters at best, and sometimes running a mile or two. But these have basically disappeared. I know of only a couple that persist. They've been overgrown with Chinese tallow tree, or with baccharis or something of that sort, are just managed in the wrong way. They're not burned, so they're overgrown with rubus, blackberries, etc. And or they've been plowed under. Their name for different rivers or places, some of the names are French. For example, we live in Fakatiye Prairie, which means female turkey prairie. Next slide. So what did those remnants look like? Well, this is one. You can see the giant circles of big blue stem mixed in with all kinds of black-eyed Susans. Next slide. There's a series of these, so we'll go through them fairly rapidly. This is a wet or damp region. Many of our prairies were wet. And these are spider lilies, Hymenocallis. If you're not a botanist, that's all right. I'm not a botanist either. Next slide. And there are numerous meadows, as I call them, little places that are very picturesque and have a bunch of rather low-growing, maybe a 1 foot to 2 foot height in the springtime that just bloom their heads off, so to say. So this is a mixture of wine cups and black-eyed Susans and purple coneflowers, etc. Next slide. Well, the prairie is actually a very tall structure, usually 6 to 8 to 10 feet, especially by the time you get to midsummer and even into August. So these are Rudbeckia texana. We do have some Texas plants in Louisiana. It's a brown-eyed Texas coneflower, right? It's about 5 feet tall, maybe 6 feet tall. Next slide. In late June, we have an explosion of Physostigia, obedient plants. Some places have literally thousands of them. Well, had literally thousands of them. They're called obedient because you can move the flowers around and get your picture perfect, ready for your shot, right? Next slide. The most common wildflowers in the Cajun Prairie were in the sunflower family. And they include blazing stars, gay feathers, lots of different names for these things. This is one, Liatris spicata. It blooms during mainly late July, early August. There's an even more spectacular one that blooms from the end of July, the end of August into September, and that's Liatris pycnostachya. It's about 1.5 feet on the average, taller than this one. So. But otherwise, they're very difficult to tell apart without a hand lens. So we get almost 3 months of blazing stars blooming from one prairie to another in southwest Louisiana. And they can become abundant, as you see. They do like disturbance, so in many of these remnants, there was some disturbance occasionally, tractors passing through them, different flooding events, etc. And the blazing stars thrive in that area. With mild disturbance. I'm sure when buffalo were moving through, they disturbed it just enough to create a wilderness full of blazing stars. Blazing stars are tremendous pollinator plants. It's impossible to go into one of these meadows or prairies and not see butterflies and bees. Well, back then, by the hundreds, now things are disappearing, so you'll see a few. The white in the way background is a wet area, and that's cacalia blooming, a snake root. I forget the common name. Next slide. There's Gail and Daniel when he was about 3 years old, or two years old, on one of our tours. We've been doing this for almost 30 years, taking people out for tours. We do it twice a year for our Cajun Prairie Habitat Preservation Society. You're all invited. And we'll tour you through restorations now since the remnants are essentially gone. Next slide. My good friend Bruno Basari, who's written several books and articles with me, in a meadow or in a prairie with Liatris pycnostachya. He's almost 7 feet tall. No, not really, he's about 6'4". But you can get an idea how tall this is. Next slide. And there's Dr. Allen. Unfortunately, he's not facing us, but he's walking through the big blue stem. Big blue stem is the real sod maker in our prairies. Little blue stem is common also, but big blue stem is the giant. It'll get 7 to 8, even to 10 feet. He's a good 6'2", so you can see it's up there around 7.5, 8 feet. And this is during September. So old stories, I'm sure you've heard them. Coastal prairies in Texas that if you're riding side by side with someone horseback, you better keep track of them, because if you get any distance apart, all you're going to see is their hat. And if you get too far away, you're going to both be lost, trying to yelling for one another. Next slide. Of course, the prairie in the late fall and winter turns red, yellow, brown. In Louisiana, we call them paille jaune and paille rouge, which means red straw and yellow straw. And of course, by the time you get past Christmas, it's brown. And of course, these carry fires beyond your imagination. Every year we burn my front yard and it's spectacular. Next slide. Now, I've written the book. I have a copy. I have several, of course. Always trying to move those. as mentioned in the intro, where I summarized what everybody had done that I could find on Cajun Prairie. A small bit of it is mine, but most of it is someone else's. I act as a scribe. I literally collect information and piece it together into a story form, or at least into a textbook form. And this was used as a textbook at LSUE for several years. I've written another one that we're now using as a textbook on mites. Now, of course, you wondered, how can you use a book on mites? But anyway, you'd be surprised. Biology is something very personal. You can take any organism and you can weave a story with evolution as your thread, using an ecological basis, and you hit all the high points. So it doesn't matter what you study. You can pick a bug or a plant or even a microbe, and biology encompasses it all. Every fundamental principle will come into play at some point or another. Now let's look at the garden throughout the years. We'll look at our garden at home. Next slide. What are we doing? Of course, we're trying to restore a little habitat as more of a recreation than a job, because no one pays us for this. We're trying to demonstrate natural landscaping, or wildscaping as it's generally called. We also like wildflowers, so we're gardening for wildflowers. We're very interested in butterflies, although there's so many airplanes flying this time of the year that we have very few butterflies. In fact, that's why we're so excited about monarchs, because monarchs seem to fly through and make it, right? Most resident populations of butterflies get hammered so badly that we just see a few individuals. Pollinator or wildlife gardening, that's all involved. We have lots of bees prior to the heavy spraying in May, and after the heavy spraying in May. And of course, we're trying to push micro prairies now, get people to look at our yard and say, I can do this, have a little prairie on my property. That's the only way we're going to save prairies, to build a little piece at a time in as many yards as possible. And it's got to be very personal. Any prairie that does not have someone watching over it is going to disappear, or someone's going to plow right through it. I walked through my yard yesterday and I was surprised. Somebody had walked through the front yard and drawn a bunch of orange lines with a spray can with arrows pointing. So I'm guessing somebody's coming in and they're going to trench right through the yard, right? To lay some cable or some pipe. I wasn't informed. I mean, my yard looks like just an abandoned field, except for the sign that's so prominently placed on the corner, right? And the fact that it's in full bloom looks pretty much like we're going to see in this next slide. Next slide.
Again?
A multiple use gardening. Oh, you can back up one. Up there. The idea is to convey to people that you can grow a garden like a prairie, and you can do 100 different things there, right? Pick and choose. You can landscape, try to make it beautiful, and defend that. And whatever you're going to do, you're going to have to defend. And that's all right. We don't mind defending what we're doing. Landscaping, and you can show that you can landscape even when there's no rain, or when there's so much rain that you think everything's going to die. Our prairies can handle that. Coastal prairie is adapted for extremely wet and extremely dry conditions. In fact, they thrive on it. It's the exotics that suffer. Outdoor classrooms, we do a lot of teaching. We do a lot of tours each year. Classes come. We do stuff for Master Naturalists. We welcome people to stop by. We push butterflies and pollination as a major goal because we're interested in ecological services. We want people to understand that trillions of dollars of net worth are produced each year because of our animals and plants. And most of that is not calculated in our gross domestic product. In fact, it's ignored, and as a result, we're going to see our gross domestic product essentially disappear because we ignore the source. We're also interested in food and medicinal native plants, and we grow a number of mints that are very common in the prairie. We've done research to show that they effectively kill Staphylococcus, Listeria, and E. coli. Excuse me. In the laboratory, they're very effective antibiotics. We also grow a number of other things. And of course, I'm very interested in historical gardening. We should grow gardens so that we can show people what the area we live in looked like 100, 200 years ago. Because they just don't know. Because of what we call landscape amnesia. If things change around you slowly, you don't really notice the incremental changes. And if no one's reminding you what things were like, you begin to think that they were always like this. And you slip into what's called normalcy bias. And you think things will stay the same, but things will not change. It will not stay the same. Things are changing, and they're changing rapidly. And they will be changing exponentially if we don't change exponentially. So this is my gospel if I'm preaching to you, but I'm not, right? You're the choir, so I assume you already know this. Next slide. So here's our prairie. It's divided by streams into smaller prairies, and they're named. Next slide. Here's our garden from a Google shot, right? You can see our house has a white metal roof. Out behind our house, straight above, is my wife's muscadine vineyard. And then the front yard, acre and a half, is cut into gardens with different moisture regimes. Right smack and dab in the middle, it's an old rice field, is where the irises grow. And then as you move further toward the road, the elevation increases, so there's more of prairie, right? So we try to have a sample of each one of the major habitats within our prairie. And the larger trees are live oaks. Tried to convince my wife to remove them when we got there. She wouldn't let me. So there are trees in the prairie, so I can't complain. Next slide. That's what our sign used to look like when we started out. And that giant milkweed that you saw in the first slide, it used to be small. Next slide. So we'll look at 2013. I haven't put together the last year. And we'll see what happens in the following slides. This is what we call a phenology. So we'll go from month to month, and you'll see the different things blooming. So let's begin. So here's our sign, our new sign with the monarchs. We're focusing, right? Next slide. So it starts off with a burn. Well, we burn the front yard, and then it starts to green up. You can see lots of basil rosettes. There are over 200 different kinds of plants in this yard. And this is my favorite time of the year because I can walk around and identify the basil rosettes, and I can picture in my mind all of them blooming at the same time, which doesn't happen. Next slide.
January?
That's more like late February, early March, right? This is Easter. Pock plants bloom at Easter time, so this is last week. Even this week, you can see the yellow flowers are diminishing. And every 2 weeks, our front yard is different, right? So if you're there in May and you come back in June, it looks like a totally different place. And that's how nature was, right? If we think back historically, you could look around and you could tell what month you were in and basically where you were if you were familiar with natural history. So the big plant that's blooming here is Baptisia spirocarpa. This clump here is Asclepias tuberosa. This is the big orange milkweed. There's actually three plants because when I started out, what I did was cheat. I put three plants together, one, two, three, in a triangle. So they would clump up and make a bigger clump, and it works. I have a place where I put five, and it's even bigger. So. Guess where I'm going. We're probably going to have 8 or 10 and see what happens then. Next slide. There it is again. So now this is next week. I can tell you right off. Next week, because I see the first couple of flowers opening on that big orange milkweed. But you see the Baptisia has essentially finished its bloom, right? In fact, there's another species of Baptisia that's blooming, and it's white in color. Right? Next slide. It likes it a little wetter, so it's closer to the house. So here's May, right? So when you get to May, things are really popping. This is when the people try to dig out the plants, you know, and unfortunately, the prairie has gotten tall enough that I can't see them from the front yard. And I've caught a couple, but actually what I found was their bucket and their knife where they were trying to dig out that milkweed and trying to pull on and yank, so it's all broken up. But they didn't get the roots because the roots are about this big around and about this long, and they're not going to dig them out. But if they knew the secret, you could take a little piece and get away with it. But they don't know the secret. They want it. Huh? But this... This is an 18-year-old plant, right? So, or actually three 18-year-old plants, right? Right? Everything that's blooming around it are mints, except for the few yellow flowers. This is a Monarda, a bee balm, right? And the yellow are sunflowers, Sylvium, Gracil. Next slide. A little bit closer. Since we're talking about milkweeds, I'm going to give you a good number of shots of that. Next slide. There it is again. Maybe I overdid it. Next slide. Now, this is June, and the milkweeds are finishing their first flush, right? So they bloom for basically a month, and then they try to produce seed pods. They don't produce any seed pods for me in this May bloom because there are no bugs. They're spraying so much, there are no butterflies, except monarchs come by, and there's no bees, no wasp, except the real nasty ones, the little, what we call guinea wasp. They do a really good job of taking out all the pollinators, so we don't expect much in the way of seed from our May bloom. But these will bloom again, so have heart, right? Next slide. By midsummer, you start to see the grasses shooting up, but the milkweeds will be blooming in and among the grasses. And here, they're done with their spraying for rice, and all of a sudden the bees start appearing, and butterflies, and pods start appearing. They start pollinating them, and we get follicles, the actual fruit. Continue, next slide. There's one blooming a second time. Next slide. This is after the bloom. Next slide. This is late June. I can tell that right off because all those obedient plants blooming along the sign. And you can see some of the sunflowers now are 6, 7, 8 feet tall. This is a different species. This is Aldo Leopold's favorite plant. It's called Sylvium laciniatum. The leaves are laciniate, and they faced the north and south, and they're used for telling direction. And they're called compass plant. And it's interesting because here in Louisiana, the stems get about the size of my thumb, but in Iowa, they're the size of my wrist, and the dang things are 10 feet tall. And in a Sand County Almanac, Aldo Leopold writes in poetic prose an essay on Sylvium laciniatum. He was watching one of them as he was driving to work every day, and it was just a lonesome giant plant on the corner, and he just kept coming back to that story and mentioning what he thought it must have tickled, because it's very rough. Must have tickled the bellies of dinosaurs. Now these things will build, these things will build a root that's this big around and that's 8 to 10 feet deep. Right? So think of a carrot. They're amazing and really tough to try to dig out. Next slide. In late June, we have an explosion of hibiscus in the wet areas. This one is called Cajun Sunrise, or Cajun Twilight, something like that is a common name. We have a rose pink. This is a relatively common species. hibiscus moschentus. It's usually white flowered or light pink, but we have a rose pink variety, which knocks your eyes out. Next slide. You can see it popping in between all the others. This is the iris marsh. Once the irises are done blooming, the hibiscus begin. Next slide. So now we're getting into late July, and we still see a little bit of milkweed, and everything else is spent. The white flowers are generally on the right. They're gara, called butterfly flower. On the left is an oryngium, or button snake root. But hidden within these are dozens of species, like this little cassia, or Chamus crista, which is the host for sulfur butterflies. Anyway, next slide. So by the time at the end of July, we have lots of, and into August, lots of blazing stars starting to bloom, and sylvium. So it looks like a traditional prairie, lots and lots of sunflowers, right? Blazing stars are also sunflowers. They just have a different presentation. So here's a place on the property with lots of these typical looking sunflowers. These are sylvium rosin weeds. Next slide. Now we're into August. Into September. I'm purposely not showing a lot of blazing stars because we don't have a lot of blazing stars on our property. We don't disturb it, so blazing stars, we have a few spots where there are some. In the Eunice Prairie, if you go to the Eunice Prairie, the 10-acre project, that one gets lots of disturbance because they harvest seed, and last year we counted 50,000 blazing stars blooming. So. We're there in late August or September, and you'll have a feast visually. But ours does not have a lot of blazing stars. But then the Eunice Prairie has only like 10 milkweeds, and most, I think all of them are Asclepias viridis. So I put a couple of these giant orange milkweeds in there, and within a few weeks they were dug up. It's just too much. I mean, easy access, and when they start blooming, people just dig them, right? So that's what, if you're going to plant milkweeds in your front yard, and you'll be tempted to because they're so showy, beware, right? They'll disappear. I can't help that, right? That's why I push viridis. Plant the ugly ones, people won't steal those. A nice sunflower. This is ashy sunflower, Helianthus malus, which blooms in late August, September. Next slide. Now we're in the late September, and our yard looks very grassy, 6 to 8 feet tall, solid grass. We'll go through the next couple of slides pretty rapidly since they just show that grassiness, and that's probably not what we're focusing on tonight. Some goldenrod mixed in. Now we know it's important this time of the year if you're thinking about monarchs, because monarchs are going to be coming back. And October is our month for monarchs into early November. And you need to have lots and lots of nectar-rich plants. They're not interested in milkweeds because they're heading straight from up north down to Mexico, but they need the nectar. So they need things like goldenrods, wherever blazing stars are still blooming, and they love the asters. We have several asters that are just bloom until they want to just fall over on the ground. And those are heavy sources for nectar. I think there's a couple of shots of them. Goldenrods, which people hate, but insects love. Now here's some of the asters. Next slide may be better. Yeah, so this is our prominent aster. This is Aster praealtus, which is just blooms. They're small flowers, but there are thousands of them. And they must be nectar-rich because monarchs love them. So when you're thinking monarch gardening, you have to plan for a spring voyage with milkweeds and some flowers for nectar, right? But in the fall, you're thinking, I have to have plants for them to nectar on their way back. So it's not enough to plant a ton of milkweed and say, I'm taking care of the monarchs, because you've done half the job. When they're coming back, if there's no nectariferous plants around, then they're not going to make it back to Mexico. So you have to think ecologically, not just about linking or saving monarchs by growing milkweeds. So I expect to see your yard just full of all kinds of big bloomers in October. October, that's usually when we forget about wildflowers, right? But that's the time that's key. I think they're probably coming here through Houston in October also. Next slide. Some more asters. Next. And we have lots of big grasses that I think are colorful. This is switchgrass. It's really pretty, isn't it? Most people hate switchgrass, but I think it's lovely. Next slide. And when you got a lot of it, it's even more lovely. Next slide. But of course, when you get to December, it's all brown and things are over. It's time to burn. There should be a slide or two here, so let's go through those. Oh, just one. Good. All right, now we'll get to milkweeds, right? Hopefully I haven't wasted too much of your time. Milkweeds. These are the Cajun prairie milkweeds. There are 9 of them, and I throw in the tropical milkweed because it's all around. People grow it. So this is kind of sciencey, but follow along with me. If you're talking to me about those from the Cajun prairie, I usually add the word Cajun prairie before the common name, right? So Asclepias tuberosa, I call the Cajun prairie butterfly weed. Common names are a dime a dozen. Every plant has a dozen, right? If it's any kind of plant at all. So this is the big orange one that everybody gets so excited about, Asclepias tuberosa. I assume it can live to be 50 years old. So if you have an established plant, you might be one of those that have an old one. Asclepias lanceolata is my favorite. I used to call it red milkweed, but nowadays the USDA plant database calls it few-flowered milkweed. I hate the name. But like I say, common names are a dime a dozen. So if you hear me calling it the Cajun prairie red milkweed, that's this plant here. Asclepias perennis, the aquatic milkweed. This one likes wet feet. But all of these milkweeds grow in garden soil. In fact, I grow them in containers and in just Walmart topsoil or composted manure, and they do beautifully. Asclepias verticillata, the world milkweed. Now, the world milkweed's a weed up north. It spreads by rhizomes, so a single plant may have 200 or 300 sprouts. But down here, you're lucky to find one with 3 or 4 sprouts. So it's not the same thing. In fact, when milkweeds are weeds up north, things like Asclepias speciosa, Asclepias sauriaca, these things are... The farmers hate them because they're just so common. We don't have any milkweeds that farmers hate, at least not in Louisiana. They don't even know what they are. Right? And it's not because they got rid of them. I think it's because they never really knew what they were. They're not that common. They're specialty plants, right? At least that's how I think about them. And the one that's as weedy as we probably have, the green antelope horn milkweed, Asclepias viridis. So let's look at some pictures of them right quick. There's the big orange. This is tuberosa, our Cajun prairie butterfly weed. Next one. Some more. Extremely beautiful. When it spreads out, you can see this is a single stem. And these things will bloom 3 times in a single year. So they bloom once, and if they don't produce any pods, they'll bloom a second time. If they don't produce any pods, then they'll bloom a third time. Or they might bloom a third time just for the heck of it anyway. And these you can mow. After they bloom, you can mow them down, and they'll come right back and bloom for you. But you have to wait till you have a mature plant, 3 or 4 years old. Next slide. Oh, and you have to check for monarchs before you mow them down, right? Up close, they're spectacular. Each flower is just a brilliant example of what flowers are. Petals and sepals, shaped like crowns. Oh, they're just gorgeous. They're really unusual in the way they're pollinated. They have a pollinium. So it takes a big insect to pollinate them. So it's usually wasps or bees that pollinate them, not small insects. The only other group of plants that have pollinia are orchids. So in some, if you're thinking about milkweeds, in a lot of ways they're the dicots, whereas orchids are monocots, and they fit, in my mind, that dual role. Same plant, or same species. Next slide. I tell you, you'll get five or six in a couple of 3 years if you're lucky. Stems, if you're not lucky, you'll just have one. I have plants that are 15 years old that are just one stem still, right? So I can't ever promise anything to anybody about milkweeds. They do what they do. Next slide. But then I don't have a green thumb. And they can be orange, yellow, or red. So I like variety in color. Next slide. Now here's that big orange one compared to the probably the easiest one of the milkweeds to grow, this little white one, which is the aquatic milkweed. But we'll come back to that one. Next slide. This is my favorite. This is the tall green, tall red milkweed, the few-flowered milkweed. It doesn't make as large a head. It never has lots of stems. Two, three, maybe. Next slide. There it is. It can be red, yellow, a combination, red and yellow, or orange. Next slide. It'll get 6 to 7 feet tall. This is Asclepias lanceolata. The leaves are lanceolate. Right? The milkweeds each have a very strategic leaf shape. So once you start recognizing them, the easiest way to recognize them is by looking at their leaves. Next slide. Here's one that's bicolored, red and yellow. Next slide. A close-up. Every bit as beautiful as the big orange one. Has a solid red one. I'm not a professional photographer, so I just shoot pictures and try to pick the best ones amongst them. Now, this is the aquatic milkweed. It comes in two obvious varieties. If it's got dark leaves, almost black, the flowers will be pink. Next slide. If the leaves are green, the flowers will be white. Yeah, like I said, this is the easiest one to grow. It's in every prairie that we looked at, every remnant strip, when you got to the wet area, it had this milkweed. So it's probably all around. This is one that can tolerate a lot of abuse, etc., and make it. I don't think it's as long-lived. I think 7 to 10 years, and it really starts to consume itself. It gets smaller, but if you keep adding manure or something, I think it keeps going. Next slide. They're prolific bloomers. They'll bloom all summer long. Next slide. And if you got them in a large container, and I'm a big, large container guy, they'll put on a show for you. Next slide. Next. Okay, yes, some more. Next. Asclepias verticillata, this is the world milkweed, right? A small white to green flowered milkweed. Likes it wet, but it can tolerate it dry. It's not really a jump out at you milkweed, but this is the one I said is a huge weed up north. It spreads rhizomatously, like so many other weeds. They were talking about some of these things that were available to you. This is a milkweed that's supposed to be like that. Spread, cover an area. I can just imagine it. Doesn't happen. Next slide. In fact, it's quite hard to grow. I don't have any of those here tonight. Next slide. There it is, close up.
Next slide.
Next slide. You might as well. There's another one, close up. And this is the one that, if you have to say there's a weed down here, this would be it. Asclepias viridis, the green antelope horn. I think it's absolutely gorgeous. And this one you can mow 5 times a year and it'll come back and bloom. Just check for monarchs, right? You can see the flowers are very different. Next slide. They have a purplish crown, and then you can see the petals around. Next slide. There are four other milkweeds, actually five others, in the prairie in Louisiana. And, of course, we have Asclepias carasavica because people constantly plant that one. Asclepias albaveda, the pineland milkweed. Asclepias longifolia, longleaf milkweed. Asclepias viridiflora, probably the rarest of them all, green comet milkweed. Asclepias variegata, a woodland milkweed. And then we have Asclepias amplexicaulis, which is in the upland sandy areas at the very edge of our prairies. And then, of course, the one, the tropical milkweed, the one that is from Mexico, maybe South Texas. People are constantly arguing about that one. Let's look at some pictures of those guys. There's albaveda. Not that attractive, but I like it. Next slide. Very hard to grow. I must have tried to transplant 20 or 30 of these. I have one still alive, right? Next slide. Longifolia, same thing. But this year I have some seed, so maybe I'll pull something off. It has long leaves. Longifolia, good name for it. The flowers are small. Next slide. You can see them. They're kind of folded back, slightly different. There are several species around that look kind of like this. Asclepias hirtella, and anyway, very difficult to grow, so I don't have any of those. Next slide. Another shot of it. Very beautiful, but if you know what you're looking for. Asclepias longifolia. Next slide. And this is Asclepias viridiflora. This is the rare one. It's generally prostrate. Lays down on the ground, and that ball makes flowers. Next slide, you'll see it blooming. Next slide, you'll see it blooming even better. There it is, next to my thumb. So you see it's not that large, but very hard to grow. We had a place where there was a couple of hundred of these plants, a remnant prairie. It is now a huge rice field. Right? So let's go. And I tried many times to transplant it in my yard, grow it. Zero. So I have a history of failures there. Very long history. Next slide. Another shot of the same species. There's always some variation. So if you were gardening with these things, you'd get really up on the variation. Next. This is Asclepias variegata, sometimes called a white milkweed. This one's common in the understory of the forest. It was really common about 3 miles from where I live now in a gallery forest. Next slide. Notice the leaves are really different. They're big obovate leaves. And you can see why they call it the white milkweed. Next slide. And finally, we get the carasavica. It comes in two forms, the yellow-flowered form and the bicolored form. Next slide. Okay. It means you can get it to your local nurseries, and we'll be discussing all these. All right, next slide. All right, growing milkweeds. This is what you came for. You really didn't come to see all these milkweeds. You want to learn how to grow these suckers, right? We're going to cover several topics: seed collection, seed storage, cold moist stratification, planting, transplanting, propagation from roots and stems, and a little bit about pests and diseases. Next, seed collecting. Milkweeds make follicles. These follicles can contain, let's see, a dozen to 100 seeds each. It varies from one species to another. And varies with how many insects you have around. Seed should be stripped from the follicle if your follicle will crack with just a gentle squeeze, right? And you just open it up, hold the parachutes, those fibers, and you can just peel the seed off and allow them to dry. Next. So here you can see a couple of follicles on Asclepias lanceolata. Here's one. Here's another. They too will have different shapes, etc. And there's quite a bit of variety as to what happens when you open them up. For example, aquatic milkweed has no silk. In fact, the seeds are wide, so they float, right? Good strategy for an aquatic milkweed. No silk, designed to float. Right? Next slide. Seed storage. Cool, dry place in your house if you have an air conditioner. Fantastic. Next slide. There you can see in my house. Just containers, label them. Just let the milkweed sit there. I used to store them in the refrigerator. No need for that. Just store them dry in the house. No problem. Next slide.
So do you leave them open? Or?
Yeah. They're just sitting there, right? So I can keep adding to them as I collect. Every day I have to walk and check all the milkweeds to check the status of each pod or each follicle. Cold moist stratification. Now, nothing new about this. It's been known for decades that many plants require cold moist stratification. I never really got into that because that's too much work for me, but about 4 years ago, I decided I have to grow milkweeds. So I started looking online, and this website, Butterfly Encounters, or go to YouTube, and you can see a number of videos on how to do this. The one from Butterfly Encounters is the one I copied. I told you I have no original ideas. I steal everything, right? I just apply it in a new place. And it works like a charm, right? When you're 6 weeks away from planting day, put your seed in a Ziploc bag, right? I've got instructions for that. If you should want some seed, we have some, and with the instructions. You place seed in damp sand in a Ziploc bag in the refrigerator. After 6 weeks, you pour some water in that. The seed should float up, and then you can take them out with a spoon, put them in cups, or put them in a large container outside, and germination should be uniform. Cold moist stratification, what it does is synchronize germination. If you go outside and you throw prairie seeds out, one may come up this week, one may come up next week, one may come up next year, one may come up 5 years from now. Cold moist stratification makes everything come up at the same time. If you do any kind of nursery work, you want everything to come up at the same time, right? It also, I think, enhances germination because if you throw things out, they get it. Right? So, or they rot, or whatever happens to them, right? And I've thrown out thousands of milkweed seeds, and I'll see 10 or 12 plants come up. And the next year, none of those survive. So I gave up on that idea. It took me a while. I had to do it about 5-6 times before I caught on. I am an optimist, right? And then, of course, when you pull them out, you plant them immediately. So it's very simple. Next slide. So you put the seed in the sand. I use play sand. You can use vermiculite. You can use any number of things. Just put the seed in the Ziploc bag in the sand and then add some water and zip it shut. Label it, right? So, okay. Next slide. There it is, all damp. Not wet, damp, right? You don't want to be able to turn it on its side and have it holding water. You want the sand simply damp. Zip it shut. Stick it in the refrigerator. Next slide. I have a little box, my special little box. Everything has to be personal. Okay. Zip it, close that little box up with all the seed. Next slide. There it is. I have one like this in the refrigerator right now. On Sunday, I'll pull it out, and it'll be planting day. Maybe 1,000 plants. We'll see how we do. Okay. Next slide. All right, planting and transplanting. Whereas the seed readily germinate with cold moist stratification, moving the seedlings is the problem. Moving the seedlings to successfully larger containers requires so-called transplanting, an event that's very stressful. Maybe not with all this rain, and you know, you might be able to pull it off, but I usually lose about half my plants, and I usually move them a couple times. So you're down from 4 to 1, like that, right? I wish I understood why this happens. I don't. But just to tell you, that's the way it works. So when you get a plant in your hands, you know, 4 seeds to get to that point. All right, next slide. Here's what my house looks like when I plant these things, right? And this is after they're germinating, you can see. Looks like thousands of plants. There may be 100 left, right? Next slide. I plant them in large containers. I'll start off with small containers, like I've brought tonight. I can show you. And then I just pop it out and stick it in a large container. In fact, I put several of these small cups into a large, the larger the better. Right? Like I say, Walmart soil or compost. Nothing fancy. You also can plant directly into those pots. Like now it's already, we're into April, so you don't have to worry about stress on the plants. You can plant the seeds directly into a large container. You don't have to cover the seeds. You just spread them out over the surface after cold, moist stratification. Hose it down or add a little water. You might add a little soil on top if you're nervous about seed being exposed. A week later, it'll be coming up. This is what they look like when they're a year old, right? The first in this row here is Curassavica. But I lost all my Curassavica 2 years ago. I had maybe 500 plants. Every one died. Right? 20 degree weather.
Oh.
No. That's the problem with Curassavica. It behaves like an annual when you get north of Houston. Right? But you can grow it as an annual, right? No problem. Just have to be aware of that. But in Houston, you don't have to worry about that. You probably have some that are 20 years old here. This is Asclepias tuberosa, the butterfly weed. And this is the Asclepias lanceolata. And you can see it's a lot taller. Right? This is Asclepias verticillata, white. And then this is the Asclepias perennis. Those five, and Viridis, which is not in this photo, those five I've successfully grown, and those are the five I push. I'm trying to work out the others, but you know, so I know how much success costs, lots of time. Next slide. So here's how it all starts, a bunch of cups with little plants. I'll be lucky if one of those survives in each cup. Next slide. Sometimes I get lucky and it's more than one, but sometimes I lose them all. Next slide. These are different species, so unfortunately I don't have a label, so I would have to be guessing. Next slide. Then I can move them to smaller containers. This is like a 2, 3, 4 gallon pot. These start off at 15 plants, right? I think those generally have 5 or 6 left in them. Next slide. Larger pots, you can put several cups in there. I like larger pots because I get larger root systems.
What's
this? I'm not a horticulturalist. They're about this big, right? And deep. I know, I bought a bunch of them 1 year and they cost $20 each. Then I found a friend who sells trees and got a bunch from him for nothing, but that's luck. Next slide. Here's what they look like about now after they've been, the plants I have here are 5 weeks old, so this is about 5 weeks old. This looks like Asclepias lanceolata, the red one, tall red one. Next slide. This is a 1 year old plants coming back up. And next year I keep them in pots 1 year or sometimes two, and allow them to multiply or at least grow. appear to multiply. Next slide. So this is the what they look like early spring. All of them starting to come up.
Are you putting these into your garden?
Yes.
Giving them away to friends?
I put them in the garden. I'm a research scientist, so I put everything in the garden. Because now I'm at the point where I'm going to start selling and sharing, right? Because I think I know how to do it now. Up to now, if I tried to sell something, I said, look, you got a 25% chance of getting this plant to survive. And since you haven't done it before, it's probably like a 1% chance. And the reputation dies with you right quickly. Besides, I have to make sure I can do it and show people how I've done it. They can improvise from there. And not blame me, because I've warned them ahead of time. Look, this is not a super rewarding occupation, so to say. But if you get lucky, if you have a green thumb, hey, you can make a mint on this stuff. I think people right now are absolutely nuts about milkweeds, right? Even Monsanto's given $3.5 million to plant farms with milkweed. I mean, that's the latest thing. The last couple of weeks, Monsanto's come out. They're going to do some.
Picture of bloating the seeds out of that permaculite.
You just put some water and the seeds float up to the surface. Take a spoon and you take them out a couple, three at a time. But I plant them all, even those that don't float. I'm an eternal optimist.
So you don't just stick the permaculite in there with the...
I can do that. I'm not smart enough not to do that. I use sand. I don't use vermiculite. That's more expensive. Play sand is what, $5 for a bag full? Vermiculite's like $20.
We sold the seeds in bags of vermiculite, which we're putting in, we've been stratifying in the refrigerator. So we have these little baggies of vermiculite with seeds in them. But we have to float the seeds out, or should we just...
I would plant the seeds on the surface. So I'd float them out. But that's me, you know. You have a green thumb? All right, next slide. Okay, that's the same. Go ahead, next slide. I don't know what I've done. Next slide. Oh, now these are different species. This is Asclepias viridis.
Next slide.
Next slide. I've got names on these, so I'll plan ahead. Verticillata, Asclepias. Tuberosa, this is the big orange one, right?
So are you gonna dig each of these out?
Yes, I'll show you that. I'm going to hurry along to get there. Next slide. All right, so I've done different things. So here I've just, at some point I just got tired of trying to replant them, so I just took the whole pot in the wintertime and dumped it out and put it on top of the ground, right? Next slide. So there's a pot, and you see... They're coming up. All right, so pretty good, even though that thing's standing above the ground. Now I planted out 6 of these. Now only 3 persist. So they're dying. I'm running out of time. Next slide. And so this is what they look like. This is the big orange one, the one that I found the hardest to grow. Next. That's about right now. They look like this. Next slide. This is like next week or week after they get ready to bloom. And then they start blooming. Here's where I planted 6 or 7 plants, and now it's twice as big since a couple of years ago. Next slide. Propagation from roots and stems. You can do stem cuttings. About 1 in 100 will survive. You can do root cuttings.
About
well, that's pretty good. I like those odds. It's been worse. Yeah, stem cuttings, rough time. Unless you've got a greenhouse and you can mist them, I stick them out in pots in my yard, right? Root cuttings, much better success. If you cut them right now or maybe 2 weeks ago, root cuttings a couple inches long, they should sprout. Only trouble is they probably won't bloom the first year. Right? Growing milkweeds, if you get them to bloom the first year, you've probably been fertilizing them and really taking good care of them. and but they may die that winter. I don't know if blooming the first year is really good for them. Next slide. So here, I tried cuttings. None of these survived. Next slide. This is Asclepias albivata. These cuttings are Asclepias perennis, and they appear to be rooting, so I'm optimistic. These are stem cuttings, different species. This is the aquatic milkweed. I think it's going to make it. Next slide. So this is what I'm going for at the end of a year. This is Asclepias lanceolata. You can see the root. I could literally cut these two pieces off and make three plants and successfully do that, right? Next slide. Pest. Milkweeds, of course, attract lots of different kinds of insects. Some of them are good, some of them are bad. If you grow milkweeds, you're probably familiar with oleander aphids, those little yellow aphids. They can do a lot of damage as far as making the plant weak. But if you start trying to kill them with insecticides or things of that sort, you'll probably do in your monarchs too. So the really best thing to do is with your fingers, kill them. But watch out you're not squashing monarch eggs, right, or larvae. Next slide. This is the bane of my existence, the milkweed stink bug, right? There's probably two or three species. These guys, once you have your follicles, they will literally sit on those follicles and suck the life out of each seed, right? So if you're not constantly walking around and killing these guys between your fingers, right? And there are multitudes of offspring, you'll get your follicles, but the seeds will not be viable. Right? So there's a one-to-one relationship with how good you are at squashing these stink bugs and the number of viable seeds you have. Next slide. This is one some other people hate. I don't see a lot of this one. This is one of the beetles, a leaf-eating beetle. In some places, these guys will eat every leaf on your milkweed. You're going to have to squash those guys, right? At my place, there's not too many of them, so it's not a lot of squashing. They're beautiful. I hate to squash beautiful things, but you got to make a choice here, right? You want monarchs or you want these beetles, right? Pests and different kinds of visitors. Lots of wasps attend milkweeds. They pollinate milkweeds, so you have a love-hate relationship. But they take monarch larvae and put them in their cells for their young to eat. Right? So the wasp will essentially, once they find one monarch larvae, they'll work the entire plant and take every monarch larvae you've got and feed it to their young. So you have to more or less kill some wasps, right? Or suffer therewith. Next slide. Diseases. Unfortunately, there's some mysterious rot which I get. I'll have a container of milkweeds or a milkweed in the field, and it starts to wilt one day. And so I'll quickly dig it up, and the root has turned to a mush. So it's obviously some kind of fungus, and there's not much I can do about that. I mean, I've lost a lot of plants because of that. Next slide. Milkweeds are decidedly difficult to grow. And difficult to move from one place to another, which I think is the biggest problem if you try to grow them and move them. Next slide. But you take the seeds. Here's a follicle, and here's a seed that's opening up, right? You want to collect the seed before it becomes like this, because then it's a nightmare. Although I saw a neat video online how to get the seeds out of this. You pile them into a container, you drop a match, and the silk bursts in the flame like that, and the seeds all fall off the triad. But yeah. Next slide. Next slide. Here's my suggestions. Grow as many species as possible. One or two may be better suited for your planting site. Do not plant seeds out of doors in containers after cold moist stratification. It's best to plant them inside, unless you've waited till April, then you can plant them outside. Move them during the dormant season, just as they're breaking dormancy, after a year's growth in those large containers, right? I've written up those recommendations on a little sheet. So you can pick up one of those if we have enough. If not, just email me. Next slide.
So when exactly how would you know when they're just breaking dormancy? What's the dormancy?
You see them come up. I'm going to show you some green, right?
Okay, that's it.
All native milkweeds die back to the ground, disappear in the wintertime. So when they see them sprout,
then you
that's when you start moving them, because then you can monitor with the sprout what's going on. So here's some seedlings, just seeds thrown out into a pot. Next slide. This is, if you're just planting directly in a pot, you can see them coming up. Next slide. No problem. So right now I recommend if you get seeds, just after you cold moist stratify them, put them in a large container. Here's what you want. This is Asclepias tuberosa. They're all twisted up because I had 6 or 8 plants growing together. And then, of course, here's how I plant them. Next slide. Isolate the plant. Next. Dig with a shovel. Make a hole. Well, not really a hole. Just a spade cut, right? Next slide. Slip the plant. You can see the plant right here. Slip it in so that the crown is right level with the soil. Next slide. And then mash it with your foot. And walk away, right? And if it's raining like now, you'll probably get most of them to come back, right? You can see the little milkweed right here. Next slide. Now, we don't have a lot of time to talk about monarchs, so we'll go through the slides quickly. They are the symbolic insect of North America, right? Monarchs are the most recognized of all insects. I know everyone in my generation knows what they are. Hopefully, everybody in the next couple of generations know, but they are disappearing, right? They're threatened because of GMOs, for one thing, and just urbanization in general, and modern agriculture. Right? The use of Roundup and 2,4-D is just wiping out the milkweeds. They're also cutting down the forest that they overwinter in. And the massive use of insecticides contributes to their demise. Next slide. The caterpillar has this wonderful coloration that tells the birds and things that it's poisonous, but a lot of things eat monarchs. Next slide. The pupa is beautiful. I mean, this looks like an emerald gem. Next slide. And of course, out of it comes a butterfly. All of this takes roughly a month from the time an egg is laid. They overwinter down in Mexico. And of course, in the springtime, they move up all the way to Canada. You can see here, Houston is a major part of the flyway. So you guys are in monarch heaven, right? Over in Louisiana, got a little thin line. Next slide. And there's our monarch with a milkweed. Next slide. We're going to go quickly. Up north, you got some fantastic pink milkweeds like this one. Next slide. But they need asters when they come back in the fall. Next slide. More asters. Yeah. Now here's the monarchs were discovered overwintering in the late 70s in Mexico. And since the 90s, they've been monitoring the populations. Here's the crisis. You can see the number, this is in hectares, dropping to an all-time low in 2013-14. 2014-15, we've come up a little bit. I blame you for that. Next slide. Everything eats monarchs, spiders, insects, some birds, they just taste them once, but they're still taking them out. Next slide. Biodiversity is the key, and if we're going to save monarchs, we have to think ecologically about biodiversity. Lots of different kinds of milkweeds, lots of different kinds of pollinator plants, lots of different kinds of pollinators. Because it's not just saving a monarch, we have to save a system. But in our way of thinking, we humans need an emblematic organism. That's why the Endangered Species Act is written the way it is. Our actions can either eliminate biodiversity or create and maintain biodiversity. Next slide. Non-natives. There's a lot of discussion now about growing tropical milkweeds. The information is very biased in one way or another. I'm wide open. Some of the accusations are that tropical milkweed gives the wrong signals to monarchs, so they overwinter in the wrong place. Right? Some people claim that there's lots of OE spores. OE is a protozoan parasite. Next slide. My good friend Roy McLaughlin described this parasite. And of course it destroys the larvae of monarchs. But OE is found on almost all milkweeds. But apparently if milkweeds die back to the ground in the wintertime, the number of these parasites drops off. So if you cut your Brazilian milkweed back to the ground, that should work, right? Anyway, there's a lot of argument out there. I don't have a solution. If you're going to grow milkweeds, I would grow a mixture of species. And why not try to grow natives, because they are fantastic. Next slide. So my solution is biodiversity. Mix it up. Get as many different milkweeds and wildflowers growing on your patch of property. A prairie is the way to go, because monarchs are a prairie species. No prairie, no monarchs. Next slide. So anyway, by the loss of habitat is the reason we're losing monarchs. Next slide. I just give reasons for this. Monarchs need plants in the spring, milkweeds and other flowering plants, and they need them in the winter or fall. I can't make that point strong enough. Next slide. What can we do? I think I made that message clear. Reduce your use of biocides, plant milkweeds, grow diversity. Right? Every town, business, school, think of a garden is the only way. If we choose the other way, we'll eliminate the monarch. It's almost certain. At least we'll eliminate the migration, which is a big thing right now. Next slide. Caution, if you're buying milkweeds at the store, oftentimes they treat the seeds with neonicotinoid insecticides. And once those chemicals invade the seed, every part of the plant will be poisoned. Right? They also have GMOs with BTI in them, which kills monarch larvae. So, but anyway.
What about like oil and spray it on?
Anything you do to kill insects on milkweeds may imperil monarchs. I don't have a solution. Next slide. Caveat number one, hey, in Texas and Louisiana, we've got a wonderful climate. We can grow lots of milkweeds. Right? Especially you guys in Texas. You're perfect, right? Next slide. Anyway, we talked about growing tropical milkweed. It's almost native here, so you're not part of that real discussion. Next slide. And the other thing is federal protection. There's a big movement now for placing monarchs under federal protection, whether it's labeling them as threatened or whatever, rewriting the statutes in such a way as to treat the monarch as a special kind of organism. There's a lot of debate, and of course, Monarch Watch, if you're familiar with monarchs, you'll go to monarchwatch.org. Chip Taylor, probably the most famous scientist dealing with monarchs now, has written a strong opposing response to protecting monarchs. And of course, as I said, Monsanto's given $3.5 million. Obama's given $3.5 million. So there's money out there to grow milkweeds, right? To save the monarch. But again, there's a strong, committed group who want to see the animal protected. They believe in federal protection. So I'm on the fence. I like the debate itself occurring. I don't think it's a solution, but at the same time, it might be. You never know. I've been wrong. I was wrong about ethanol. I thought ethanol was going to be the key. Right? Turns out it takes 1.1 gallons of gasoline to make a gallon of ethanol. So. But yet, with all the federal subsidies, they can afford to do it. So, and the environmentalists were the ones who pushed that legislation through. So we make lots of mistakes. Next slide. I've seen only two monarchs so far in my yard this April. I'm blaming you guys. You've planted so much milkweed that they're here eating, and I'll see the second generation, right? Next slide. There's our gardens. If you visit them now, next slide. Next slide. You'll be seeing Louisiana irises blooming in quick succession. That's one called a Chaffalaya. This one's called President Headley. This one's Cherry Bounce. Black Widow, my favorite. And a yard full of irises. Next slide. Questions, right? We had a few, but let's take the rest of them now. Yes?
Do you notice any preference between species for monarchs?
Monarchs will go to any species we have that I've shown you that I've monitored. They seem to prefer, in my yard, Asclepias lanceolata. But that doesn't mean anything, because I don't have a lot of monarchs like you guys have. Yes? I'm guilty of a little Miracle-Gro and time release, and while they're in containers. When I put them in the ground, that's it. They either make it or they don't.
I saw that in the big containers you had clumps. Does that mean you put the little teeny containers?
Cups, yeah. But I took them out and just plugged them in.
Oh, but you took the paper part away.
Yeah, well, plastic. I dump it out and stick it in. Yes.
Is there any preference for distilled water?
Yeah, that's what I was
Never touched it.
Never tried it.
Can't afford that kind of stuff.
It's gone.
Yes. I've done that. Put them right into the ground and they disappear. Now I've put the little cups into the ground and I get about 25% success.
Yeah. Could you use like organic fertilizers, like alfalfa pellets?
Never tried it. That sounds like money to me. If you notice, everything I do is very, very cheap. I am cheap.
Just cut it at a joint, or can you just like the
you have to have a node.